And with that, if there are any questions. So, so it's interesting. It was 200 years ago during the Industrial Revolution that there was an advocate for factory workers who was suggesting that the workday should be limited to just 8 hours, because back then it was 10 to 16 hours. You may remember the mantra was 8 hours of work, 8 hours of recreation, 8 hours of rest. And I'm thinking, just 8 hours, that would be great. I know my days get into about 10 p.m. today. So it's interesting because according to surveys by the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics, the average American does in fact work 8.8 hours every day, but is only productive for 2 hours and 53 minutes. I thought that was fascinating. And so the article goes on to talk about what is it that they're doing the rest of the time, reading, and we know what they're doing. They're reading news websites, they're checking social media, they're chatting with coworkers, getting coffee. So if we're only productive for about 3 hours a day on average, how many hours can you truly say we have time to lead? That's why I think leadership, at least in my opinion, it isn't about one person or one philosophy or even one moment in time. Leadership demands much more. So I sat with my communications team and talked about my thoughts on leadership. And of course, they came up with something clever and said, talk about the ABCs of leadership. Since we're in the education industry, that seemed relevant. Leadership, they say, begins with A, and that's always acting with a sense of urgency. You know, when time's short and there's really none to waste, I don't like to wait. But acting with urgency doesn't mean acting without thought or a clearly defined mission. Once you set your direction, you want to make gains as quickly as possible, or risk that those around you will start thinking your mission just really isn't that important. And they've got other things to distract them, Facebook and coffee and so on. So on my first official day in Columbus as superintendent with the schools, I spent the better part of the first 3 hours with the auditor of state. I don't know if you recall, but at the time there was a very dark cloud of controversy hanging over the district. As state auditors had uncovered questionable changes in the student attendance data. So I understood that as the new leader of the district that was embroiled in controversy, I needed to act urgently and not ease into that position. So I met with those people that best understood the situation and could provide the greatest light on the challenges with which we were confronted. And as a district then, we acted very swiftly to hold those who were culpable accountable. And by acting with urgency and by investing the time at the very onset of this new administration, we demonstrated that the reestablishment of our data integrity and the restoration of the public's trust was, in fact, our highest priority. So in that same time frame, we also established a new set of goals as a guide to help all of those who were connected with the district understand the new direction. Those immediate actions were taken with a great sense of urgency, and they were very public and very impactful in both the short and now the long terms. Any kind of delay would have diminished the trust and the respect that we earn. So A is acting with a sense of urgency. B is being brave and bold in the direction. And this is one that I think is very, very tough. Being brave sometimes means you have to admit your shortcomings, and being bold might ask you to think bigger than those before you. 3 years ago, at the beginning of the 2013-2014 school year, the state began the implementation of the new third grade reading guarantee. Simply put, if the third grader can't read on the third grade level by the end of third grade, they're ineligible to be promoted to fourth grade. On the first administration of the test in Columbus City Schools, only 42% of our third graders met that requirement. That's less than half the third graders who would have been eligible to be promoted to the fourth grade. And there were those around me who said, you can't tell the public that we're only at 42%. They'll think we're failing as a district. But in fact, we were. And so as you've heard before, you can't address a problem unless you're first brave enough to admit that you have one. And so we didn't shy away from that score. Instead, we used it as the rallying cry. And we didn't simply call for more classroom time devoted to reading or teaching to a test. We put books on our buses so that students could read on their way to school and home. And we launched a series of family workshops and academies to invite parents together and give them free time to continue the reading and learning going on at home. Our team even went door to door over 900 homes of students who had not passed the test to find out what more could be done, including a first of its kind intensive summer boot camp for third graders specifically on reading. And I'm proud to say in that first year, we led our third graders from 42% to 88%. Of them meeting or exceeding the requirements of the third grade guarantee. And then the following year, we reached 91%, And last year, we reached 91% again. So that's over a 50 percentage point turnaround 3 years in a row. And it started by being brave and being bold. Next on the list is C, which simply stands for communication that is both clear and consistent. And at the beginning of every school year, I commit myself to visiting everyone in the district, not just in every school, not just in every classroom, but every cafeteria, gymnasium, office, warehouse, on the buses. As you know, we are the biggest district in all of Ohio with more than 52,000 students and 9,700 employees stretched across 147 sites, including, you probably don't know this, we have a camp right up here in Westerville on the other side of Hoover. So while it takes me a few months to visit everyone on the list, I think it's important that everyone sees and hears from me in our district. But that clear communication also demands transparency. In the first year, we led substantial changes to raise the level of accountability on student data and to reassure the public that our records were sound, accurate, and honest. We put in wide-ranging controls and procedures that were developed and implemented to ensure the fidelity and accuracy of student attendance and the related data. And then, in the spirit of true transparency, we opened our books and put that data out there for everyone to see. We launched the first ever district data dashboard, which offers unprecedented insight into student attendance, enrollment, academic achievement, even the number of cafeteria meals that are being served today for breakfast and then again for lunch. It's updated every single day and it's disaggregated by demography. Then we added a new financial dashboard allowing users to see where every dollar in our district comes from and the amount of every check that is written. And to make sure that no one feels we only put out communication that's positive, we made certain we launched a mobile app that offers constant feed to information and news, and we have over 10,000 people who have downloaded that application so far. You know, on TV, you can debate which is real news or fake news, factual or alternative facts, but undebated is the human need to know what's going on and that the work that they are doing is actually making a difference. So our communication also includes constant reminders of our successes. We branded it the Spirit of Success, and it's a new sense of purpose and pride in our work. So the next time you're on Twitter or on social media in the time outside of your 3 hours of productivity, search for our hashtag Spirit of CCS. That's hashtag Spirit of CCS, and read for yourself about our students' achievements. Two more letters in the list of leadership qualities. D is for don't be deterred. We've all been in a place where our focus and our attentions are pulled by the unexpected. The problem of the day draws the public spotlight with such intensity that it can melt away your resolve and your concentration on what's really important. Don't let it. Stay driven in your purpose and persist, even when it seems like the change has become too difficult. I've shared with you my intense focus on reading improvement. However, frequently there's a new fad or new research that someone either in Washington or at the State House believes should be the new priority. For example, recently a state representative drafted a plan to require that students spend time learning cursive handwriting. And while I believe in the power of good penmanship, I also know that our learners are growing up in a digital age, and their abilities to quickly use a keyboard provide them the greatest access to learning and growth. And more importantly, I know the value of classroom instructional time. It's very limited. And so deviating from the focus on our basic literacies should only be done when the metrics and the materials warrant. It's also easy to be deterred when change seems to stall or is no longer as evident. So I mentioned we jumped from 42% to 91% of our third graders meeting or exceeding the third grade guarantee, but we still have 9% to go because we want to be 100%. And those are the very reasons a leader needs to persist in their expectations and to reinforce much needed inspiration. Without it, the results will slide and movement, take over a tremendous amount of energy to spark, can quickly grow cold. When our test results dipped a little bit this last fall, we quickly needed to re-spark our reading efforts and energies, and we needed to expand the call for help, which leads me to my final point, which is the letter E, which stands for enlist everyone. So while great leaders need the courage to stand alone, great change can only be made when that leader enlists the help and dedication and commitment of everyone around them. Teaching young people to read is not just the job of a teacher. We enlisted our bus drivers, our custodians, our food service professionals, our administrators, each finding their own way to encourage and support our students. And then we have enlisted the powerful partners of the Columbus Metropolitan Libraries, the Center of Science and Industry, Ohio State, Otterbein, Columbus State, and other institutions of higher learning. I don't know if you know, but every Columbus Library branch now has a homework help center specifically geared to assist students in reading with learning tools that match those that students see in their schools and the methodologies used by their teachers. But that's still not enough. So we've enlisted our community's biggest companies, the private and the nonprofit sectors, and our faith leaders, and any individuals who were willing to answer our call. And we created a dedicated core of reading buddies to volunteer their time reading one-on-one with each student, or generously donating some of the more than 16,000 books we just collected during our Books for Breakfast drive at the local Panera locations. So education is best served when there's an all-hands-in commitment from the community, and I believe it is the foundation of Columbus City School's success and the eventual success of our students when they graduate, which is why we are enlisting everyone to set aside time on their calendars and become volunteer mentors to one of our students. We know that far too many of the children in our community are still caught in that whirlpool of poverty, struggling families, and self-destructive behavior. Children can escape that spiral if there's a caring adult in their corner, not one that judges them, but encourages them and offers both an ear to their concerns and a voice to their inspirations. So my goal now is to give every one of our students, all 52,000, the opportunity to have a mentor. In a metropolitan area of more than 1 million people, I think in the next 2 years, we ought to be able to achieve that goal. So act with a sense of urgency, be brave and be bold, communicate clearly, don't be deterred, and enlist everyone. And maybe F fires speechwriter, because it would be great if leadership, he put that in there, so. It'd be great if leadership were as simple as the first 5 letters of the alphabet. But honestly, my best advice is that you lead in your own way. Follow your passions, rally those who share in the demands and your dreams and visions. Leadership, especially when you're called to lead change, is about mobilizing people behind a shared purpose. It's about harnessing that limited 3 hours in the day when employees are most productive. And ultimately, it's about serving your community, serving each other, and for those of us in education, serving the young people who come up behind us. And so I'm going to stop there and allow you to ask any questions you'd like. You know, that was way under 20 minutes. I did. Any questions? Yes, Ms. Robbins. Yeah, I asked myself that daily. I retired from Westerville City Schools, and the last 2 days of my contract with Westerville, I took vacation leave. And those 2 days, I actually served as an assistant superintendent for Columbus City Schools, and then assumed the superintendency the day after that on July 1st. And it was to be an interim role. My job was really to come in and address the data issues, the infidelity of the data, not only the way that it was collected, but the way it was stored, the way it was extracted, and the way it was represented, and then also identify what were those processes and policies that allowed for that to happen and assure that we put new policies and processes in place so that it could not in the future. And then, of course, hold people accountable for that. We move very, very quickly, as I said, letter A, right, with all urgency. And I think there was enough momentum, and the approval rating of the district and its leadership was growing significantly, and so then the board convened just a few months later and invited me to stay a few more years. And then my contract actually runs through the end of next summer. So, yeah, my retirement job, 16 hours a day.
You talked about the third grade reading achievement. Do you think that eventually that success that you had there will ripple up through and show itself at the high school level, at the high school graduation statistics, that these kids who are doing better reading will do better at the other end of the pipeline?
So the question was about the impact of the third, our focus on reading and print literacy acquisition at third grade on graduation and even bachelor's degree. There's actually a very strong correlation between the students that complete their secondary education and their performance in that third grade. And beyond that, you can even actually make some highly predictable estimates about who will graduate from college and even about how many kids they'll have and how many time, where they'll live and so on. We've begun to see the uptick in the number of our graduates. And we measure that a couple of ways, not only those we offer diplomas to, but also in dollars that they secure in academic scholarships. So we were up this past year $15 million in scholarships to our graduates over the previous year. The previous year we were up $10 million over the other. I do believe there's a strong, not a cause and effect, but certainly a positive correlation there. The key, though, to really helping students graduate is to understand that students don't need us for a content download anymore. They don't need a Dan Good standing in the front of the room lecturing them, giving them information. They can access all that digitally at this point. What they need are ways to apply that in very relevant, very meaningful applications so that they can understand and assimilate those new skills. Because once you learn a new skill, no matter what context in which you learn that skill, it's transferable to a new context. So we have students, for example, that are now participating in engineering internships beginning in their middle school year. They have no desire to be engineers. But the skills they're learning, so many of those about communication and cooperation and use of the computer to access information and new ways to solve problems, will transfer to whatever career they ultimately choose. So when students are engaged that way, they're staying in school and they're graduating. So in order for them to be successful, though, in those internships, in those problem-based learnings, they do have to have those literacy skills. So the answer is yes. The short answer is yes. Yes.
I work in IT, and you were talking about the data integrity initiative that you had to go through when you jumped in. So data integrity is very important to me in my line of work. I'm curious if you're able to share a little bit about the financial impact of shoring up all that data and the programs and processes and probably software you had to put in place to make that happen. What kind of impact was that on the district?
So thank you for the question. The question about assuring the data integrity, not only the collection of the data, but also the storing of that data, extracting of the data, sorting it, representing it, evaluating it, and so on. How did it impact the district financially? Well, it was a very expensive endeavor. I was very, very fortunate. One of my colleagues, who also retired from Westerville that same time, joined me in Columbus City Schools to become our new data czar. She would shudder if she knew I were calling her a data czar, but she became our chief accountability officer. And she really studied all those processes and studied the different applications we use to store data and how vulnerable they were to users. So she put in place many, many policies, many procedures, worked hand in hand with the state auditor's office and also our own internal auditing department, as well as the Ohio Department of Education, to look for best in class solutions and make certain we implemented them in Columbus. But the real costs, I mean, those were pretty easy to predict what kind of costs those would be. But it's the training of individuals to begin to understand what is a reliable representation of something that is what comprises data, and how can you validate that before you put it in the repository and then extract it and represent it in an appropriate way, making, you know, valid inferences about that data. Those are the real expenses, and those continue as we train people to be good consumers of data and collectors of data. So those costs are ongoing. Can I give you a hard figure? No. But I can tell you, the other costs associated with this was actually those that were culpable in the accountability piece, and the number of hours we had to expend job counseling people, maybe into different careers, maybe even seek for their severing the relationship with the district. So there were costs there as well. So honestly, I think we've got it all wrong in education. I think we focus on the student as the unit of change, and I think we need to stop thinking that way, and we need to start thinking of the family unit as the unit of change, and understanding what supports we wrap around families so that they can reinforce and sustain those aspirations of students, understand that there are pathways to prosperity, that they could realize that there are resources out there. When we knocked on those 900 doors, and our students moved from that 42% to 88% at the end of that first summer, the community didn't do backflips and say, yay, Dan. Now, what they said is, what are you gonna do for me? I'm like, what are you talking about? And it realized to me, I realized then, it was the epiphany, we are cradle through career. Our families wanna be our children's first teachers. They wanna be their best teachers. They wanna be those exemplars, those models of prosperity. And I think we have an obligation to make certain where they don't have a diploma, we offer them ways to earn that adult diploma. Where they are unemployed or underemployed, that we continue to provide those work skills programs so that they can retool and achieve their dreams. So I think that's one of the things we really have to think about, is how we And Kathy's so good at about this. All of our higher ed partners understand the blurring of that secondary to post-secondary line. I mean, we need to erase that line altogether and make certain that we're looking at that. Our oldest student is 81 years old. Once we recognize there are people out there that still want to learn and again, be those models. And it's fascinating when Mary Green, who's the 80-year-old, came in, she's earning her GED at the same time she's getting her STNA, which is the equivalent of kind of an LPN, a licensed practical nurse training. And she said she's doing this because when she goes home to raise her 8 grandchildren and she's around the dining room table, she said she wants the narrative to be different. She wants to make certain that she can speak from an informed place experientially that this is important and we're going to do this together and we're all going to move forward on that pathway. So I think, for me, we have to really think who our target market is in education. I worry too about, I've not met a parent that wants to be a bad parent intentionally. But man, there's a lot of parents out there that could use our support, understanding different ways to support their children. And so this morning, we had a third grader that we found in one of our high schools who had broken in the middle of the night, was in the library, tossing crayons, pulling things off the wall. They weren't there because they wanted to come to school. They were there because they didn't want to go home. And so we have to think about what we're doing to really support families to create these nurturing environments that support children's aspirations. That's what keeps me awake at night. And that's not an anomaly, by the way. That happens more frequently than any of us would care to admit. There was someone in the back there. Did you change your mind? You did? Okay.
With the average working day, 3 hours.
Yeah. Who knew? That was in the speech. I don't know if it's true or not, so. talk about using data and having fidelity, right? Making appropriate inferences. No, it's a Bureau of Labor Statistics data. I'm sure the 2 hours and 53 minutes represents some reality. How do we increase the productivity? I think we can do that through the digital tools we have available to us, making certain we're smart about what information we're downloading, I mean, emotionally and mentally downloading, and making certain we jury that in an informed way. I mean, I get on first thing in the morning when I wake up. If I haven't been awake all night, that's what I'm doing. I'm looking to see what the news feed's telling me has happened. So if the president's going to sign some proclamation today, I know I have 8,200 refugees and immigrant students, and I need to think about what message do I send to them to ensure that they know their children have a constitutional right to be educated regardless of their immigrant or refugee status. What kinds of resources can I provide to the family so that they know where to get accurate information? They're not who I'm responsible for, but again, looking at the family as the unit of change, how do I provide that supportive connection, linkage for them. So I think we can use technology to help us do that. I don't know how to answer that any better than that without thinking about it a lot more. Do you know? Because if you do, help us. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Absolutely. We are now. That hasn't always been possible. She asked about the tracking of outcomes following students once they graduate. Fortunately, we see some students like this wonderful cause graduate, and we can track her. In the state of Ohio, we had a student identifier system that unless you attended a public university, you weren't necessarily able to follow that individual. But we do have new tools, new clearinghouses now that can help us make those associations and understand those effect sizes. It's very, very important to me. In fact, in Columbus, kind of a different way of thinking about it, we look at every single one of our, we have hundreds and hundreds of programs we purchase from vendors or service providers. And we look at every one of them for an effect size. So again, we can't necessarily allege a cause and effect, but we can certainly see a significant change in outcomes as a result of where that program has been placed. And those are the ones we retain. We also look at how big we can scale those and whether they're sustainable. So I know that my higher ed colleagues look at their business models the same way. They're only investing where they get that significant return on investment and they can measure those outcomes and that they're sustainable. But we do it on the micro as well as the macro level. And fortunately now we have tools where we can identify where students have gone and how this has helped them.
I
Patty.
The students and the family and the change agents they are. Can you talk a little bit about your educators themselves? What is the district doing to help the educators be the best that they can be in the classroom?
Yeah, good question. Not enough. You know, as an industry, I don't think we're doing enough to really give our educators the tools to really be facilitators of the acquisition of new knowledge and application of that knowledge. And there are a couple of reasons for that. You know, back in the early 80s, there were studies about the motivations for individuals choosing teaching as a career. And the number one motivation was they like children, they like to help create those experiences for them to develop and so on. Number two were the conditions, the work conditions. Having the same holiday periods off, having the summers free, a guaranteed pension system, and so on. Number two doesn't exist so much anymore with the changes in the state's pension system and the movement away from defined benefit to defined contribution. And so that motivation's disappeared, and so we're relying more heavily on those that truly are doing this for very altruistic reasons. And a lot of times, they're informed by their experiences as students. And when many of us were students, we were not in the digital age, were we? And so we still relied on those textbooks, the World Encyclopedias Britannicas, the sage on the stage to provide that content. That's not the reality anymore. In fact, students are really turned off, in fact, by hearing those individuals that believe it's still their obligation to do that download on them. And so we need to be thinking about how we're attracting and then how we're retraining those that we currently have to understand their role as the facilitator of learning. In my mind's eye, and we started this in Westford, this was a marvelous program, the Academic Enrichment Center. Otterbein was a fabulous partner in that. Our Academic Enrichment Center was originally in Westerville designed as an alternative to suspension expulsion. So if you weren't learning in a very conventional, very traditional track, and you were facing a disciplinary consequence, this was an alternative for you. Well, number one, the students helped design that, so I don't know if you've ever seen it. It's where the old board office used to be across from South High School. It looks like a double-wide trailer with bricks, so that's where Christy hired me and put me. But anyhow, the students helped to redesign it. It's like a high-end Starbucks now. I mean, stainless steel, they've got big screen TVs, but the students come there for consultation with the educator. Here's how I would like to achieve these outcomes that will earn me a credit in the sociology class. And then they negotiate what that pathway looks like, and it's very much based in the community through their externships, through independent projects, through a walkabout experience. And it's been so successful, in fact, it stopped just being an alternative for students that were facing suspension or expulsion. It actually became a magnet for students that wanted to accelerate, that wanted to get ahead. And so we began to run a second shift there. Well, we just opened ours in Columbus this past year, and it is absolutely amazing. We're working very closely with Hot Chicken Takeover now. Students are doing all sorts of entrepreneurial activities. They're applied, they're learning, they're earning their credits, they will get their diplomas, and they'll probably graduate ahead of their class, when in fact, in that traditional trajectory, they were facing suspension or expulsion. So we have to evolve how we're engaging our students with their world and using this new knowledge to really work toward justice, healing, and peace for everybody. So, great question, but we're not doing enough, not nearly enough. Now you've decided. Getting into it. Yeah. So it depends. I think most people think of one-to-one like when a district makes a decision to buy everybody a Chromebook or an iPad or something like that. Well, tell me the last time you saw a student carrying around a Chromebook or an iPad as their mobile device. That's not what they're using. They're using their phones. So one of the smart things we did in Westerville, we also did it in Worcester, where I was previous to Western, we did it in Columbus, is we helped allow students to help us define what the bring your own device looks like and make certain we have a platform that will accommodate their Droid world or their Apple world, because they're using these, they're not using these. And so we need to make certain that we're smart and accommodating what they're bringing to the table and not necessarily asking taxpayers to provide something that, in my opinion, could very likely become obsolete at some point. These are tending to be the ones that are sustainable. Well, not this one, this is like an I-2, but it's like, it's interesting. I watched how that bankrupted districts, in fact, LA was one of those, Bath, Ohio was one of those, where they did. They went whole hog. They acted urgently, but they didn't put a lot of thought into it. In my opinion, it was like a shoot, ready, aim. And they probably needed to think and consult students on how students would use that technology and how it was going to add meaning and value to their experience. So I would make the argument we already are a one-to-one district. You'd be hard-pressed to find any student, third grade or above, that doesn't have a mobile device already. So pretty fascinating. I like the ones that project now. Have you seen those? The ones that will actually project the screen. So we're getting very close. Did you ever see the Corning video from 8 years ago where everything's going to be on glass in the future? I mean, you set your little phone up against the mirror in the bathroom. You get all your email right there. You get your news feeds. You put it on the counter in the kitchen. It's right there. You can talk to grandmother while you're cooking. It's really cool stuff. But you couldn't do that with pads and books. Are we out of time? No, not yet. Okay. Come on.
you mentioned Hot Chicken Takeover.
Yes.
A hotbed of entrepreneurial success. So can you just talk a little bit about what partnerships or programs you've been able to develop the entrepreneurial students?
Yeah, so it's a great question. She asked about what program we have in place that's developing entrepreneurial skills and interests of students. It's not one. And so people ask what my big learning was coming from Westerville to Columbus. I know you didn't ask that, I'm going to tell you anyhow. The big learning was one size does not fit all there. You have to look at neighborhood by neighborhood. In some neighborhoods, you can do a top-down approach. I could take in a Hot Chicken Takeover. I could take in Joe DeLoss, and he could talk about how he hires people that were formerly incarcerated to actually develop his product, market that product, deliver that service, and make a profit. But that's not going to work everywhere. In other neighborhoods, it has to be very, very organic. So where the 81-year-old woman is our student that's down in the Marion Franklin. We call it the Opportunity Center. They came to me and said, here's what we want. Here's what we're willing to voluntarily staff, and you have an empty building there. Could we work together to make it happen? So they're driving that there, but in other places we have kind of those top-down approaches. My point is this, there's no panacea or silver bullet in a large urban setting. We really have to be sensitive neighborhood by neighborhood, and in some neighborhoods, Linden, for example, where Cause was, it's street by street by street, where you have to be sensitive to what your intervention or what your treatment is. So relative to entrepreneurship, this is a program out of Cleveland. I'm going to forget the person's name, but I'll look it up when we're done here and give it to you. She brought it down to us. We're very, very excited. She developed a whole curriculum in this regard. But we also have Lemonade Stand. That's a program that's in Columbus, and we've worked with Kurt Chaffee in that. And that's now a credit flex opportunity for any of our students, and you actually begin with developing a lemonade stand. And there's a lemonade day in the city of Columbus where students actually put up their lemonade stands and sell lemonade. And they use it kind of as a what we call a mini society experience. So they start with the notions of scarce resources and supply and demand and go through that whole understanding how you procure resources, how you use those resources to develop a product that's responsive to a market need, and then you scale that, realize a profit margin. The nice thing is in both Lemonade Stand and in the program out of Cleveland, it's not just about the economics of it. It's also about understanding the social parameters that have to be in place so you're not raiding each other's businesses, about the ethical considerations you have to have so you're generating an honest product. And so it moves from micro society to macro society focus or macroeconomics focus. So there are a number of those, but I can get you a list of them. They're great programs. Excited about them. Dr. Kendall trumps all of you. Sorry. So. So Betsy DeVos, you know, is our new Department of Education Secretary and President Trump's appointee. Yes, ma'am. So, and thank you. No, that's okay, because actually Betsy and I agree in some things. I am not one of those superintendents you're going to find that is going to bash charters or community schools. In fact, I think competition has been very, very good for public education. The ones that I don't hold in high regard are those that are poor performing, obviously, or don't have accountability associated with their business and operations model. So I work very closely with the three highest performing community school or charter schools in Columbus now. And we're even looking at potentially having feeder patterns. So They're very good. One of these charters is very, very good at attracting new talent and developing them, Patty, on the front end. They spend weeks and weeks and weeks helping refine their executive functioning skills and how they teach those executive functioning skills to children. When I say that, you have to remember the children, you know, 91% of whom live in economic poverty now in Columbus. Things that we take for granted are not things you can assume about these children. Passing on the right side, how many sheets of toilet tissue you take at one time. Those are executive skills we have to talk about and think about in order to prepare them for living in this cooperative world. And so this particular charter school does a very, very good job of onboarding these new teachers, and they're phenomenal. And the results they get for their primary learners, kindergarten, first, second, and third grade, are amazing. They outscore all the other charters, outscore the district. But then about that fourth year, those teachers aren't going to earn as much as those that are in a union shop, and I have a union shop. And so they drop off, they leave. So why not make that a part of a feeder? Why not make that the only option in one of our pre-K 12 feeder patterns? So if you want that high quality experience, you're going to go to this particular charter, your pre-K 1, 2, and third grade years. And when that teacher's ready to leave, they loop right on up with the students that move into the district system for 4th through 12th grade. The teacher comes with them, earns the union wages. So they're, I'm not saying that's gonna happen. I'm saying there are models out there where we can work together and build on the best of the best. So I use that as an exemplar to say that not all of what you hear or read about Secretary DeVos is antithetical to what some of us believe and talk about. I think she does have some good notions relative to how we can begin to collaborate better and make certain that only the best options are available for all of our families. I am also a huge proponent of parent choice, huge proponent. My family in Alaska homeschool, not because they don't have value in the public school system, but because they live in the bush and that's the only way you could give your kids an education. So I think homeschooling is relevant too, but I think those are things we need to think about. There are different delivery systems and there's no reason they all have to be combative. There might be ways they can be cooperative, and what a wonderful model to use for our children. So relative to policy, I think that's an important one. Relative to local social policy, I will tell you, we've got a springboard off that. We have to do something about the growing mobility in our region. Right now, we're sitting at 27% mobility. So over a fourth of the students in this classroom will not be here by the end of the year if you're in Columbus City Schools. And that's beginning to look more and more the same in the suburban schools as well. And part of it is just because of the nature of work and parents don't have to be place-bound anymore to earn an income. But the other part is because we don't plan for how people can stay put when they don't have the rent to pay at the end of the month. And that's a very, very real concern, because when we talk about correlations, mobility is a very, very positive correlation to poor performance. So. Me personally, yeah, I have multiple issues. Yeah, right, right.
So, what's your team look like so that you can address all the issues? Because you can't be everywhere. So, I'm curious, as a leader, how do you build that team to help you solve some of these issues?
So, good question. So, I don't want people to ever think that I can't be everywhere. You know, I don't announce when I'm coming. I do go to every single classroom, like I said, in the district. I want our teachers to always be on. I want them to always be doing what's best for children. And if that means they're concerned that someone may be watching or someone may come in and make a judgment about that or an observation and share that observation back and it isn't consistent with what they believe they were doing, I think it's okay. I think it's okay. We work very, very hard to balance, to your first question. It's not really a balance. I really think those things are so fully integrated anymore. So we talk about writing, for example. This is a good way to share some of what's going on in your life, to articulate that in print media, right? Or through visual media, to develop a video. And so we make certain we're using those students' real life experiences, their trauma-informed experiences, as the context for the content that we're teaching. So if whether it's, you know, a social studies theme or whether it's a reading theme, there's probably a real life relevant incident they can use and elaborate on in that context. So we try to make certain they're fully integrated. It's very difficult to parse them. And I say that, we had 23 violent acts that resulted in deaths last year. 17 of those were from gunfire for students, none of which occurred in schools, by the way, all in neighborhoods. But we also situationally have care teams that we deploy. So for example, for the young lady that was in the high school today, we'll make certain we're at her school today with a number of social workers and our counselors' care team to try to provide the kinds of supports that teachers need so they can say the things that will make the student feel reacclimated and included in that environment. We do the same whenever there's a shooting in a neighborhood, whenever there's a loss of a parent or family member. So it's both and. It's both integrated, but then also situationally, we have mechanisms where we deploy the right sorts of resources to support our children. I interview every administrator. We have 379 administrators, so no one serves in a leadership. Everyone's a leader in our district, but no one serves in a formal leadership capacity without first my sitting with them and understanding that we're fully aligned, or that they're a source of cognitive dissonance that's important for me, and to help us grow and keep me fresh as well. So it's all of the above. Is there any sort of formal strategy? No. There was a hand back here. Yes, sir.
When you make pretty bold changes when you first started, when you start talking about like home visits, I'm finding it hard to believe the staff meeting got really excited when they heard the word home visit. And I'm just wondering like the challenge you had getting everybody on board and kind of getting everybody together toward a common vision. Yeah. I mean, as big as you are, that was a pretty big goal you had. Mm-hmm. And I'm just curious if
yeah, so good question. Couple of things, though, and again, it's a big district, so lots of things were going on. We were actually involved in a five-year study with NEA, National Education Association, where we drew down $1,250,000, so it's $250,000 annually, to actually support teacher home visits. So we actually built up on the successes. We learned who a parent's going to respond to if that person walks up on their front porch, and believe it or not, there are certain attributes that if you have those attributes, they're more likely to answer the door than if you don't. So we had that kind of granularity of data to inform who we would deploy. The other thing to remember is the Ohio Teacher Education or Evaluation System, OTES, in Ohio actually associates student performance with part of your performance appraisal. So there's an incentive, a performance incentive, for you to ensure your children do well. And if that means you go to home and try to get parents to send their children to that summer boot camp, you might be more willing to do that if you know it's going to be their positive outcomes on their reading assessment are going to be reflected in your evaluation. So a couple of those things we're going to. We spend a lot of time talking. I don't make decisions in a vacuum, or I try not to. So we have, and we did this in Worcester, we did it in Worcester, in Worthington, I was there. We have a collaborative decision-making model. So I have the leaders of my four unions meet with me on a monthly basis in my cabinet, and we sit down and we talk about the issues. For example, last year, mid-year, burnout was really high. It always is about January, February. But a big part of this were new reporting requirements from the State Department of Education. And we sat and we talked about what could we do to show staff that we're sensitive to that, also provide them the time to complete those reports with fidelity. And you notice I just keep pointing to you as though you're the only technology person in the room. And so what we decided to do is come up with a records day. And we decided that will be a day where everyone has professional independence. You had to focus on something that was in your role description, but there would be no, I would not prescribe any other activities, no workshops, your principal couldn't do that. And let me tell you, that went a mile. So we ended up putting it in our calendar for twice a year, beginning this year and next year. And on those, it's records day. Mm-hmm. And so on those days, everyone's given professional autonomy. You do what you need to do. You're a bus driver. You need to clean your bus, you clean your bus. You want to think about a different route to pick up that's more efficient, you work on that. But everyone's afforded that professional accountability. To Patty's point, empowering them, giving them that autonomy and that independence. So that helps. The way we make decisions helps with that. Last question. Yeah.
I have a question. You talked a lot about mentoring.
Yeah.
So what does a mentor look like?
Yeah.
Of it's not just the child, it's the family. You've got
So first, to answer mentoring, we built on a model out of Manhattan. It was called the Success Mentoring Model. It's very, very intensive. It's not a remember their birthday and show up at their band concert model. You actually give 1 hour a week, and that is face-to-face time with the student. And it's very specific, the kinds of engagement that you have. But it's also very non-judgmental, as I indicated before. You serve as kind of the advocate in their corner, the coach, showing them other options at their disposal, helping them think about what consequences of each of those choices. But it's an hour a week. So we started that last January, and we tried it at 5 high schools. South High School was one of those. At the time, the students on track to graduate at South High School, only 22% were on track to graduate at that high school. I don't mean they just needed to finish their year's classes and they'd be okay. I mean they had shortages in test scores, they had course credits they were deficient, they weren't coming to school, behavior incidents. So we started there with the mentor program. At the end of the year, we had 78% of those students graduate. So they were getting multiple credits, not just the ones that they were going to get anyhow their senior year. It does work. In fact, it works so well. We were one of 10 districts noted by the White House. They brought us up there to talk about that initiative. We scaled it this year to all of our high schools and three of our middle schools this year. So we focus on 12th graders that are off track, 9th graders that are at risk, and then we have some middle school pilots we're working on as well. That's our mentoring model. It's like Project Mentor on steroids, frankly. There are a lot of wonderful, wonderful nonprofits that already offer mentor programs, so we work closely with them, along with the Community Connector grant recipients, to make certain there's fidelity with the program that they're implementing, and so that it emulates kind of what we're seeking to achieve. Yes, the parents need this, you're absolutely right. There are a number of organizations in town that are looking at what they're calling those linkage services. So you know that United Way now has a hub model. I don't know if, probably not here, but it's in Columbus's United Way, they have a hub model. Future Ready Columbus is looking at a hub model. And this is where they're actually social workers or caseworkers that serve as that mentor for the family. And I do think that's critical. A lot of times our student mentors fill that role automatically. So the good ones really build those relationships with the parents so the parents know that you're not there to supplant them. You're there to support them and supplement what they have. Okay. I do. Wow. They saved the zinger for last. I think we have to remember that boards of education in this state are essentially volunteer positions. They're remunerated at a very, very low level. They don't have aides, they don't have cars. This is not like a city council position in Columbus. In urban settings, it's a little different, I understand, than suburban settings. In urban settings, a lot of time that board of education position is viewed as a stepping stone to a city council position, which is paid. You have an aide, you have a car, and so on. Or it's considered a stepping stone to a state representative position. And a lot of times, if you look at the history of urban district board members, you'll see that kind of career pathway that they've been on. So understanding kind of what their motivation is to begin with is really important. And people in this state, probably all across the country, they generally run on an administrative platform. You don't hear many people running for a board of education say, I want to develop new policies and appropriations, which are really their only statutory authority. They generally say, we're going to deal with this, and that's what gets them elected. So understanding that that's kind of what they're about, and you need to honor that and figure out how we can help them achieve what their goals are for their constituents as well, because those constituents clearly believed that was important or they wouldn't have elected that person, and that's who they represent. We actually, in Columbus, it's a big board. It's a board that it rules more by caucus than consensus, and so it's generally a 4-3 on most issues. Now, they'll vote in alignment with each other, but their discussions, they tend to come down on both sides of issues. And so it's been really interesting working with this board. We actually have a formal retreat this coming Tuesday, the 28th. Someone will be facilitating that to help them understand how to have constructive conflict and work towards consensus versus always landing in caucus around issues. But ultimately, the board is one. It's not 7. It's not 5. It's not 3. It's one voice, and they're only a board when they're in session. But ultimately, I report to a board, as does the treasurer, as does the internal auditor. And so we need to make certain we honor what their policies and appropriations would allow. That, did you get that film?